HRN listeners. As we celebrate our 15th year, we are deepening our commitment to giving voice to the next generation of food system storytellers, and we need your help. Our internship and fellowship programs help activate new possibilities for underrepresented and underestimated young people through experiential journalism, audio engineering, and production training. Through these unique programs, HRN helps food equity stewards build essential workforce readiness skills that expand their potential and foster economic mobility. Please consider supporting these critical programs. And with a minimum donation, you can be entered to win a dinner for two at an amazing restaurant in one of 8 cities and tickets to a concert at a great venue in one of those cities. We have incredible partners across the country who have donated, as they also share our passion for helping to educate the next generation of food system storytellers. Check out heritageradionetwork.org/15 to donate and enter to win today. That's heritageradionetwork.org/15 to donate and enter to win today. And make sure you donate before March 31st. Thank you.
Today's program is proudly brought to you by Whole Foods Market. Visit wholefoodsmarket.com or download the Whole Foods Market app to learn more and find the store nearest to you.
Ever heard of a popcorn-driven robot? This week on Meat and Three, we're bringing you stories about the intersection of food and tech.
We're interested in building swarms of many cheap, small robots and powering them and driving them forward with as little effort and as little energy as possible.
We cover tech by land.
Imagine if you could cut fresh microgreens onto your salad and eat it while the greens are still fresh and nutritious and delicious and alive. That dream is real.
We cover tech by sea.
We're building software-based business services to help shellfish growers manage and grow their business.
And we cover tech in the social media stratosphere.
So it's not really necessarily an indictment on food media or for media consumption at all. It's how the robots decided they were going to weight human interaction.
Tune in and get techie this week on Meat and Three, available on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hi, I'm Moxie Rosenblum. My dad, Harry Rosenblum, hosts Feast Your Ears on Heritage Radio Network. Right now, HRN is having a summer membership drive. Becoming a member is so easy, and you'll help support shows like my dad's. You can sign up for a one-time donation or become a monthly sustaining member by visiting heritageradionetwork.org/donate. Let's keep food radio on the airwaves this summer.
Welcome to the Grape Nation, your weekly wine journey. Our guests are Federico Carletti and his son Francesco. We'll talk to Federico and Francesco about Tuscan wines, Sangiovese, Poliziano, and more. We'll taste a single vineyard Vino Nobili di Montepulciano for our weekly wine sip. I'm your host, Sam Benrubi. Stay with us for the Grape Nation on the Heritage Radio Network. We bring wine to the people. Federico Carletti's father, Dino, started the Poliziano Winery in 1961 in Tuscany. Federico took over in 1980, overseeing 300-plus acres, eventually bringing in his son, Francesco. Poliziano produces a state-grown Vino Nobili di Montepulciano, Rosso di Montepulciano, Cortona, and more, including Asinone, Losa, La Stanze, and Inviolas, to name a few. Poliziano wines are known for great quality and great value. I want to welcome Federico and Francesco to the show, to the Grape Nation. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for inviting us.
We're sitting with their importer in New York at Winebo, and we're talking to them about their trip in New York and their wines. All right, so Federico and Francesco, so people know more about the winery. I want you to give us a little background together in your journey in life and wine that got you where you are today. You came in with your dad, So just give me a quick history, I guess from 1960 on?
61, yeah. Okay. To start off, we need to bear in mind one specific thing related to the Tuscan region back in the 60s. Over there were noble people which used to own thousands of hectares all around Tuscany, and they were splitting them into small portion of vineyards, of land, where one house, which was called Mezzadria, which in Italian specifically means splitting up the land, used to cultivate the land and use the land for themselves. So basically what happened was that in the 60s, the noble people didn't have enough money to invest, invest on new tractors, try to sort of develop a new way of working the land. So the people were protesting. They didn't want this. They wanted the investments. So the government took over, got all the lands, and sold all this small portion of land. And in 1961, Dino Carletti.
My father was in that moment really open to buy the first small piece of land, 22 hectares, with a small house, and started to plant the vineyards. My father was a manager of a company that built the houses.
Non-wine related?
Non-related, but he was born in Montepulciano, exactly where we bought the first part of the
vineyard. What was his drive or his passion? Sow the land, grow grapes.
For my father was a really romantic spirit.
Okay.
In that house, the sister stayed during the bombing of the Second World War. And my father bought only for romantic things, to stay during the finish of the job. But he planted the vineyards, and when I started to study, I make agriculture engineer in Florence. And I finished in 1978, and after 2 or 3 years of experience in the north of Italy of other agricultural business, I came back and I started to work for Poliziano.
So when you went to school for agriculture, was it in the back of your mind that maybe one day you'll get into the wine business, maybe with your dad, or not necessarily?
I didn't make enologia. I made viticulture.
Okay.
Because it was really another century for the wine in Italy, for the wine of quality. But I arrived in 1980, and I understand that I was very lucky, because it's changing the world. We speak about before the Canada, in 1982, 1983, I sell for the first time 3,000 bottles of Vino Nobile di Montepulciano in Canada, in Opinion Society. And I understand that we can make good wines, we can make a good business, we can have a market in Italy, but have a market in all the world.
So from 1961 to 1980, your dad was running it. He started growing, making wines. He was bottling and selling.
It wasn't bottling. It was just
growing.
The Scuso. Yeah, growing, okay. And he was selling the Scuso.
He was selling.
In the
okay.
Big,
so Federico, channel. When you came in, that kind of modernized everything.
I started to bottle the wine.
So when was that moment when your love for wine, you know, you realized,
yes,
this is it. I'm putting my feet on the ground. Hands to the soil.
I realized that the job was a wonderful job, because I met people from Chianti Classico, from Brunello. I started to visit other countries. I understand that is a different work of the work that I believe in the university, to make only the manager of the agricultural manager. And I started to make investment. I make the brand of Poliziano with the face of the poet, because Poliziano is...
We were talking about...
Tell who romantic, Poliziano is.
The idea was the romantic idea of my grandfather to buy that specific place and to call it Poliziano, because Poliziano is the nickname of a famous poet coming from Montepulciano. His name was Angelo Ambrogini. He moved to Florence afterwards in his life, and he was the teacher, personal teacher of Lorenzo il Magnifico, which was the richest and the most powerful person in Florence during the Renaissance period. And he was nicknamed Poliziano specifically because he was coming from
Montepulciano. So it's an ode to those guys.
Everybody who's born in Montepulciano is called Poliziano. If you're born somewhere else and you live in Montepulciano, you're not a Poliziano. You are a Montepulcianese.
That's it, right? That's good
so
to know.
The tradition is a really important factor.
So Federico,
but, in 1982, when I arrived, when I started to sell wine and bottled wine, the name is my father chose,
right.
But the brand with the face of the poet I made
right.
in Florence is a very very nice thing. So I go to the graphic to explain. I say I am a farmer. I want to show that I make wine with my hand. He make for me a symbol so strong, like I was a worker. I mi sono offeso.
I offended.
And I say, but it's better Poliziano. Work about Poliziano, and this is the brand. And our label is the same label since 1982, 1983. The Vino Nobile is the same label.
36 years.
The Asinone that I made for the first time, 1983, that's the same label since 1983.
You don't like change. So just let me ask you something. When you started really getting dirty in the 80s, who was doing the winemaking? Was it you? Did you bring people in? Were you overseeing it? Who was out in the field supervising it? Did you put a crew together, or you were?
Was my friend, because we make the university together.
Okay.
It was Carlo Ferrini, that now is very famous enologist, have several different very famous.
He was
famous,
your initial winemaker?
Yes.
Okay.
But Carlo Ferrini is my friend. We met for the first time the 1st of September of 1972.
Okay.
It's a long period.
Right, so I want you to, I don't think there's anybody better than you guys. I want you to talk to me about Tuscany as a wine growing region in general. And then I want to talk about Poliziano, you know, where your properties are. So Tuscany, if you had to, you know, sum up Tuscany as a wine region, give me your fact sheets on that.
Yeah. Tuscany is a wine region, but I think is very old, but also very new, because it changed a lot. I understand that changed a lot in the 80s in the Tuscany wines. In Tuscany, in the past, the wine was very old. The denomination was very old. To understand, we had in the Vino Nobile di Montepulciano rules 30% of white grapes.
Was part
crazy.
Of the mix?
Yes, in 1970. And we changed. I have an impression, wine impression, that Tuscany wines challenge in the world change with one wine, Sassicaia 1985.
Super Tuscan,
Sassicaia.
But how much Sangiovese is in there?
Yes, but the people understand that we can make a wonderful wine.
So it brought attention to the region?
Yes.
Okay.
I remember exactly the man that write for the first time Super Tuscan. It's Barton Anderson. He's a journalist from Minnesota that worked in Greve and worked in Cortona. And he called Super Tuscans because he says, okay, if the table wine is more good than the DOC, I write Super Tuscan. Super Tuscans help us to work well about Sangiovese.
Right.
When I understand that we can sell Sassicaia, we can win all the testing with Sassicaia 85, I said, okay, but I want to work more and more about Sangiovese, to grow in the quality of Sangiovese. And I made, in the last 25 years, a lot of things to grow in quality. Clonal selection, choose of rootstocks, density, different
right.
Different canopy, different... now I am organic. I make a lot of things because I understand that Sassicaia and some very good Brunello can go in the market and can have a successful. And I understand in the 80, I understand these things.
Right.
And when in Italy there is the two big scandals, I don't know if scandal is correct for the American people, but one is methanol, they added alcohol with methanol.
Right.
I multiplied my fatturato, my business outcome. For two.
Right.
Each year, you understand?
Right. So, when you talk about Tuscany, you bring up Sassicaia, Super Tuscan.
Yeah.
So quickly, the region, the terroir, the diversity of land, soil, the climate, obviously it's great to grow for Sangiovese, but somebody realized Cabernet and Merlot was growing well. So as far as climate, soil diversity, is there a lot of diversity of soil? Are there a lot of microclimates?
Yeah, Tuscany is very different. But it's very different also my winery. I have 130 hectares of vines in Montepulciano, and we have a different position, different origin, different altitude, different exposition.
We are different position to the sun, altitude,
yes,
soil, actual
altitude,
location.
Altitude, humidity is completely different. We have large estate like Medoc, like Bordeaux, but we make specific wine, single vineyards like Burgundy. This is my opinion. In this moment is my opinion of the Tuscany after 40 years of work in my winery.
Right. So you got to tell my listeners this, all right? Because Tuscany is, one of the most prominent wine regions in Italy, and there's probably 3-4 wines that come out of there that are tremendous and popular. There's Chianti, there's Brunello di Montalcino, there's your Vino Nobile. What's the difference between the wines? I don't know if people ask that question, but we're talking about are Sangiovese-based wines. Let's not talk about the Super Tuscans for now. What's the difference between a Vino Nobile and a...
It's different countries. Chianti Classico is higher, is colder, and make wine very elegant, with high acidity.
So it's the region, the region. Climate, which we discussed before.
Absolutely, the climate, the origin. Brunello di Montalcino is the best area to make Sangiovese because of the stones in the soil, it's dry
the
position.
Roots have to struggle more and more intense.
The quality of the Sangiovese is very strong because they have a lot of skin, a lot of phenolic, and they can age the wine in 4 years in the cellar and to go in the market with very soft, very strong, but very soft. It's very difficult to have full body wine, but very elegant, and they can make. Montepulciano is in the middle. We have the acidity of Vino Nobile is lower than Chianti Classico, higher than Brunello. We have a very good color, more colored than Brunello, more colored, more phenolic. Probably we have more tannins because in the area of Montepulciano, the land is more clay than in the other. We have
the clay will create more tannins.
Yes, the clay, absolutely. If you test fruits from clay, if you test a vegetable from clay, there is more tannins, more structure.
Right.
And we need, we are work a lot to have more soft tannins to make a structure only of the noble tannins, noble wine and noble tannins, and we work a lot in the last 40 years for this question.
So the location, the terroir, climate, that has a lot to do with what you're saying. I mean, winemaking style, you could try five different Brunellos and they're five different styles, modern, old, and all that. But when you talk about Vino and Montalcino, Montepulciano, each area, Chianti, has their own characteristic, which makes it softer, more tannic, more acidic.
I think the style is more important than the origin. I am really focused about the right. origin. The origin is the end of this, the land, the end of the position is very, very important.
Right.
Now the rules is changing. In Montepulciano, we are having more and more Sangiovese in our, no more white grapes, of
right.
course.
Done
but
with that.
Now we are growing in the percentage of the Sangiovese. We have 70, but we are going about 85% Sangiovese. I make a new single vineyards 100% Sangiovese. Is changing also the rules in the last in Chianti Classico day the percentage of Sangiovese is 85% now is 85. Yeah. They started the 70 and they go 85. This is the changing.
Right. So you started talking about your style. There's a Poliziano style.
Yeah.
There's a style you, Federico, brought in,
yeah.
you know, with all the changes, getting rid of the wine, more modern, all of that stuff.
Oh, the
Let's talk about that style. Are you taking a more modern approach, would you say, towards?
The Poliziano style is very simple. When Federico Carletti was young, look to international wine, to three stars restaurant, Michelin, blah, blah, blah. Now I came back in more and more in the tradition. I am old man, I came back in the tradition.
Not that old.
Yeah, I am old, okay. And came back in the tradition. We are speaking with the third generation for this question, because I have 64 years. And I came back into tradition, but in a very modern style, because now I am, it's 10 years that I am organic.
Wait, say that again. Follow tradition, but a modern style.
Yes.
There's a mixture of both.
The tradition is the grapes.
Okay.
I am planted in the last 10 years only Sangiovese. And I planted 33% of my selection of Sangiovese, and the other 67% other clonal selection of Sangiovese.
Right.
I have a perfect shoes of the rootstock now because I know I have experience. I use the correct rootstock in the different land. I am organic. I don't use more chemistry fertilization. I don't use disherb. I don't use spray. I don't use pesticides.
When did you start doing that? Did you
25 years for the fertilization? 10 years ago for the desherb, and now again.
So you're moving towards sustainability,
absolutely.
Organic?
Absolutely organic.
Why? I mean, the answer is obvious, but I want to hear it from you.
Because in my garden, I can eat fantastic tomatoes. From the market, I eat no good tomatoes.
Tomatoes People go through such trouble to get organic, beautiful produce.
Yeah.
And then they'll just drink some crappy wine.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so sustainability.
Yeah. But because I have experience, I found in the wine residual of small treatments. We need to have poor wine, and the organic help. But not only the organic cultivation. Also the selection of the yeast, no more selected yeast,
intervention.
My naturalist, and that's another thing very important. And also the aging, don't age all in small barrels. I made in 1990, but now I age it in small barrels, big barrels, 600 liter, 3000 liter. I wanted to mix the
right.
aging, because if you have only new barrels from Bordeaux, from France. Allier region, you test Allier oak, no wine.
You want diversity in the barrel aging.
Yes, this is the thing.
Let me ask you a question about organics. It's great that you're going towards a more organic platform. What about the region? It doesn't do a lot of good if you're doing it and the guy to the right of you and the guy to the left of you doesn't care. Is the region
growing?
Everyone is kind of buying in.
It's growing.
Okay.
And also, some wineries, not a lot, is in the next step, biodynamic. No more only organic.
Do you strive to go biodynamic?
No, I say
that Rudolf Steiner.
I am agriculture engineer. I am not able to understand. I read the book about the biodynamic, about Steiner. I speak with the other producer, but I am not able to understand. I am too many days in the winery, too many days in the vineyards. It's impossible. I am looking, but I am not able to understand.
I got that. You talked about this a little before. I want to expand on it a little more. The trend in non-Sangiovese blend wines, you said started, I mean, you really pinpointed it to the mid-80s, to Sassicaia. Did it become popular right then and there, or gradually more winemakers started growing and blending non-Sangiovese wines? But what happened from that point on?
I think from 80, more people blend the Sangiovese with other grapes. And now, more and more people in 2002, 2003, 2005 changed the view. And now, more and more people stop to blend the Sangiovese with the other
grapes. They're doing Cab and Merlot, right?
Yes. There is some people that are looking for traditional grapes of Tuscany to blend with the Sangiovese to have less tannins of the
what
Sangiovese.
What kind of grapes?
Colorino, Canaiolo, and Mammolo. But the results is not so good. I think the results will be very good to have a good selection of Sangiovese, good rootstock, no vigor, but good balance, a perfect phenolic ripeness of our Sangiovese. I know when I very good ripeness, phenolic ripeness, I can make very soft extraction, I can make a perfect extraction of the tannins, and have a very good wine, very elegant wine.
Are there any Super Tuscans that they put Sangiovese in?
I make Super Toscans, but I make international wines in Super Toscans.
Right.
Is L'Estanze is Cabernet Sauvignon, and In Violas is Merlot.
So we're now like in 2018. The region, what percentage do you think is making non-Sangiovese wines?
Oh, my winery, 85% now.
Is non-Sangiovese?
No, it's Sangiovese.
So 15%. What about when you look around to everyone else? They're moving a little away but similar?
From less. I am more young in the market, more... sono più attivo, sono più...
He's more active, he's more ongoing for the Sangiovese.
Right. But also the other is moving from 70 to 75 to 80%.
Right. Well, let's talk about the wines now, so you'll be able to talk about the blends and all of that stuff. We talked about the fact that you make a lot of Sangiovese, you make a Merlot-based wine, Cabernet, Sauve, blended with some other interesting grapes. You're re-releasing a wine that you made years ago called Cagioli.
Yeah.
Let's start. We'll talk about all your wines, but talk to me about Cagioli first.
Oh, Cagioli is a very interesting thing. I bought the region in 1985. I started to bottle the wine because the quality was very, very good in 1988. I made for several years, 88, 90, 92. 93, 94. I stopped in 94.
What would drive you to make it? The quality of the...
No, it's very good. Good. Okay. Sangiovese, not 100%, but 85%.
So the crop would determine whether you were going to make that wine or not. The grapes. Right?
Sangiovese and Canaiolo is old, very old vineyards. It's traditional grapes of Tuscany. But the wine was very good. I decided to stop to make Le Cagioli only because... we in that period we say Tuscany is like like Medoc. We make two wines, first wine, second wine, a lot of winery. If you look in that period, make Castello,
Bordeaux really separates
Castello it. And normal Chianti Classico, several different wineries make these shoes. In the end, after other 20 years of work, I understand that Tuscany is completely different of Medoc. Medoc is geographic, morphologic, and geologic is very poor. Tuscany, we speak a lot before, is different altitude, different exposition, different soil, is so different. And when I planted again the area of Gaggiole, my wife says, my wife is a very old family, and says, oh no, ma, you are too modern. Plant again in Sangiovese, plant again. I explained it because I dedicated the wine to my wife, of course. And I planted the new vineyards of Gaggiole, 100% Sangiovese, with the very good rootstock, very different. Clones is the best shoes of these clones. And after 5 years, I start to have very good wine. I use it for the regular Vino Nobile. I try. I put one barrel out to test, to understand. And I decided don't make 11, it's too warm. Don't make 12, it's too strong. 14 is difficult. But when I arrived at 2015, I keep the decision. This is the new wine. And I call Nobile di Montepulciano, Le Cagiole, dedicated to my wife, 2015.
Is the 15 in the market yet, or it's
no? Is in the market in September?
Okay.
Because we are
this fall
is a bottled, is the final wine, but we'll be in the market in September.
All right. So, Federico, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk about the other wines. There's a lot to talk about. We're talking to Federico Carletti and Francesco Carletti from Poliziano Winery. You're listening to The Grape Nation on Heritage Radio Network. We'll be right back.
Oh, won't you save all your pumpkin pie? Oh, won't you save all your pumpkin pie? Oh, won't you save all your pumpkin pie just for me, girl? Please don't give none away. Let it get sweeter by the day. Oh, won't you save it, baby? Won't you save it? Oh, won't you save it all for me?
Today's program is brought to you by Whole Foods Market. From papayas and samosas to reishi mushrooms, if it's something that sounds delicious, chances are you'll find the freshest, best version of it at Whole Foods Market. They have more than 400 stores across the country, so if you consider pizza its own food group, or just can't imagine when avocado toast wasn't a thing, Whole Foods Market has you covered. Visit wholefoodsmarket.com to find a store near you. Whole Foods Market. Whatever makes you whole.
Let it get sweeter by the day. Oh, won't you save it, baby? Won't you save it?
All right, Federico, let's talk about... So we talked about Cagioli, which doesn't get released that often. We're going to taste one of your... in a few minutes, we're going to taste one of your important wines, the Vino Nobile di Montepulciano, the Asinoni, which is a single vineyard. But let's talk about the Vino Nobilis, which is... Am I correct in assuming... Of all your case output, a large amount of that is the Vino Nobile?
Yeah.
It's una larga quantità di cioè
yeah, yeah.
La più importante come anche quantità.
The regular.
The regular.
Yeah, yeah.
And
the regular the Vino Nobile is the bigger production of Poliziano.
All right, so tell me about the Vino Nobile di Montepulciano, the regular, and then the Asinone. Yes.
Wonderful. Allora, the regular Vino Nobile di Montepulciano we make in different parts because we made parcellar cultivation. We are very focused about the quality. Different parts. We use to make the Vino Nobile di Montepulciano the older trees, the older vineyards, and the best position, of course. And we harvest in 1 week. That is the perfect week to have the phenolic ripeness.
When is that? September, October?
It's changing, okay. but in the end, October is the month that where we harvest the best Vino Nobile. We make manual harvest. We make two selections for the wine because the first selection is in the vineyards. The workers harvest only the very good grapes. And the second selection we make in the cellar. We have the photo optic machine to select the different fruits, the different berries for the color, for the sides, shape, and for the sides. After that, we make a long fermentation, 20 days, very soft fermentation with natural yeast. We make
the longer the fermentation, the softer the wine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And we make 20 days of extraction, very soft extraction. We don't want to be strong about the skin. The skin is really perfect when I finish the fermentation. After the fermentation, we make malolactica, and we age it for 14-18 months, depending on the different vintages.
Is there any regulation to how long you have to age it, or you determine how long?
No.
Because doesn't Brunello, the Montalcino, yes, have regular...
Vino Nobile di Montepulciano had 10 years ago, 2 years in the oak. But now we changed the law, the rules, and we can stay in the... We must stay in the oak only 1 year.
1 year.
And after we make minimum 6 months of bottles. I make...
So there's 6 months of bottle age? Bottle, sits
yes,
in the bottle?
Yes. I make 14-16 months of aging in the oak, and after I make more than 6 months of bottle.
Now, are you aging the Vino Nobile in all the different sizes?
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
The large, small, now, you practice that.
And after the parcel harvest, we start to make the blend of Vino Nobile. In the end of the harvest, we have 10 different Vino Nobile altogether, but 10 different that we age in the different oak. And in the end of the second year, we start to blend all together, and we make the bottling of the Vino Nobile all in 1 month. It is 250,000 bottles. It's a very big production, very big production.
Terrific.
That we sell really in 45 different countries.
So what is the Rosso?
Rosso is the younger vineyards. The more the altitude of the Rosso is lower, about 300 meters. The Nobile we harvested about 350, 400
similar
meters.
Similar winemaking process or?
Shorter fermentation.
Shorter?
No
okay.
Oak. Only one part, 20-25% of the wine age in the oak. The other age in the cement tanks, in the concrete tanks with a glass inside. And we bottle after 1 year. We bottle in September of the second year, we bottle the Rosso di Montepulciano. Is a young, is our first level wine. It's
right.
Very, very
it's great
young.
Value wine.
Yeah, it is good.
It's delicious and the
smell
price point
is cherry, perfectly cherry, fruit, very, very, very ripe. It is good wine for the table, for all the different dish.
All right, let's talk about some of the blended wines you make. You're using Sangiovese, you're using Merlot, you're using Cabernet, you're using some other grapes. I'm going to throw some names out in any order. You make a Lestanze, Inviolas, Losa. Let's talk about those. What's Poliziano Super Tuscan?
Poliziano Super Toscans, because if you remember, I believe Stassicaia 85, the lucky of the fortuna, the lucky of the Italian wines. And I made Super Toscans for this question because I understand it's very good wines. I came back in why Losa, why Merlot?
Because Losa, L-O-H-S-A, is a Merlot?
No. It's a Morellino.
Morellino. Okay.
Explain. The philosophy is very important. I believe that the wine, we make the wine in the vineyards, from the grapes. And for the question, I buy several different land, one in Maremma.
Yeah, all around Tuscany.
Maremma is by the
yes,
water,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, right next to the coast, on the south.
Coastal.
Right next to Grosseto, that area.
So totally different type of grape because of the sea air, the climate.
Because I think, my opinion, the wine we make in the from the grapes. And also Cortona, I bought it because it's a wonderful place, wonderful estate. I want to make
Where is Cortona?
It's close Montepulciano.
Okay.
It's in the east side of Montepulciano.
Okay.
We are in the...
And you're growing Merlot there?
Yes.
Okay.
There is also Syrah. I planted the Syrah, but I am not happy. I don't bottle.
Okay.
I make only the Merlot. And for this question, I make... all this estate, I have a free estate in the end, because I wanted to make wine with my grapes. I don't want to buy nothing.
Everything is estate-grown grapes.
Yes, I am estate.
Even grapes. The Rosso, those absolutely are all your own. You're not looking to increase the case out.
All the wines is product from my grapes, because it's my idea, it's my philosophy. Really, the market helped me, because I have more bottles in the very good vintage, and less bottles in the no good vintage. Why? Because with my grapes, I must make selection if I want a good wine. And when you make selection, what happen? The difficult vintage, you make a few bottles. The very good vintage, you make a lot of bottles. I am very lucky of these shoes.
Sure.
I don't want to change, absolutely.
Sure. All right, so if let's just kind of list everything. So Losa is the wine you make in Maremma, and that is Sangiovese.
One part is Sangiovese, the Morellino di Scanzano.
And Morellino di Scanzano. And you also make a Morellino di Scanzano too, or is that it?
Two, Morellino di Scanzano and Mandrone.
Right.
So we one make Cabernet and one Sangiovese.
The other is Mandrone di Losa, Cabernet right. Sauvignon.
Right. And then the wine you make in Cortona is Inviolas.
Inviolas.
That yeah. is a
100%
Merlot.
Yeah.
That's like Federico's Masetto, right?
Oh, no, Masetto is
I'm joking.
Fantastic wine. Fantastic wine.
All right, and then La Stanza.
Oh, La Stanza.
Tell me what La Stanza
is. La Stanza is great wine.
Is that Cabernet?
Cabernet Sauvignon, mostly Cabernet Sauvignon.
And you blend some other local indigenous grapes? Or?
No. The Stanza was every year 100% Cabernet Sauvignon. No,
Bordeaux blend,
Cabernet,
right?
Mostly Cabernet Sauvignon with sometimes Merlot, a blend of Bordeaux.
All right, so did we cover all the wines? Is there anything we missed, Francesco?
We cover all the wines. We also produce a very, very small production of white wines, but we only...
What grapes?
Chardonnay. And Sauvignon.
Leave the country, or...?
No, they're just in Tuscany.
Local.
They stay in Tuscany.
Okay, I'm sure those are terrific wines.
Go ahead. We also produce the dessert wine, Vin Santo, but that's also...
What's the grape for Vin Santo?
Malvasia Bianca del Chianti.
Is it always that, or you decide what Vinsanto grapes you want to use?
The rules of the Vinsanto di Montepulciano.
Malvasia
or Grechetto.
Okay.
And we use Malvasia del Chianti.
All right, before we're going to taste the Asinoni, and we're going to talk about that a little. But before we get to that, it's always hard to ask a parent, who's your favorite child? It's just an impossible question, but people get asked. What's your favorite wine of the 30 plus years? Is there a wine that's the closest to your heart?
Of course, Asinone. Remember, I made for the first time in 1983. It's the first single vineyards made in Montepulciano and one of the first 10 single vineyards made in Tuscany.
So it's the most important wine, the Vino Nobile. And then you were able to really make the wine you want by growing a single vineyard and controlling the grapes. I figured you were going to say that. All right. Every week on the show, we taste a different wine on the air. For our weekly wine sip, which we end the show with, we're going to taste the Vino Nobile di Montepulciano single vineyard Asinoni. Francesco, what's the vintage year?
2015. Yes. So very good vintage.
This very good. So tell me quickly about the vintage, you know, the condition.
As he was saying, he was explaining that with each vintage, depending on how good it is, we do certain cuts of the productions.
Right.
For this specific vintage, 2015, which was an amazing vintage in terms of the summer was very warm, but not too warm, so the sun has fully developed its own characteristics. We cut 10-15% of the production, so it's for the Asinone, it's a really, really good, really good vintage.
And how many, the grapes come from
one specific single vineyard, which is...
It's always the same.
Yes,
12. Site, yes. Right? The Asinoni site is always that site over there.
Three blocks, but all together, in the difference is the age. Because one vineyard is planted in 1965, the other planted in 1990, and the other planted in 1995. It's a different, only the age
you
of
You have
the,
a good variety yeah. of age vines.
This is a Sangiovese, called in Montepulciano Prugnolo Gentile. This is a really Prugnolo Gentile, because in the old vineyards, there is only the Sangiovese original or from Montepulciano.
Scott, what's the approximate retail on this? Not exact ballpark.
Around 40.
$40. So you're getting one of the great wines of Tuscany, a single vineyard. I would say, without going out on a limb, $40 is an incredible price. All right, so we talked about the vintage, 2015. Anything different making this wine in 15, or basically you followed?
No, it's the same process. Process. So
there's a difference between the Asinone and the Vino Nobile.
Right.
As he was saying, for the Vino Nobile, we use an optical machine which scans and independently decides which grape and which specific juice is mature or not. Whereas for the Asinone, we do the hand harvest.
Manual.
But also the selection of the juice is done by manually. Yeah.
Interesting. So you get the most quality.
Exactly.
Control.
It's very important because we have the machine is so fast and we decided to make it manual.
Right. All right. So like I always say, let's give it a sniff and let's throw it over the tongue and let's talk about it. So first of all, color. Deep.
Deep.
Dark.
But not
purple.
Black.
No. It's got a beautiful deep dark.
Yeah.
Garnet red with beautiful, you know, lighter edges.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so that's the color. I need you to tell me what you get on the nose on this wine.
Oh, blackberry.
Blackberry.
Plum.
Plum. So black fruits.
Yes, black fruit. Dark berries.
Dark berries.
But also floral.
Floral, did you
say? Yes, violet.
So dark flower, not
yes.
a white flower,
violet,
but a dark
violet.
That's what I'm getting. All right, so let's give it a sip. Let's throw it over the tongue. Let's talk about mouthfeel first. It's a very full-bodied wine.
Full-bodied wine.
Very opulent.
Balance it.
A lot of balance, a lot of depth, right? So the mouthfeel is, there's great depth, great persistence. It stays there. All right, Federico, tell me on the palate. Does the palate reflect the nose, the
yeah.
same black fruits you picked
yes,
that up?
Of course.
Anything else?
Yes, of course. But you test also good ripe tannins. Tannins is very ripe. You test that.
The tannins?
It's no.
I love the tannins.
Yes,
they're
it's ripe.
They're young and strong.
But ripe.
Very ripe and rounded. And I think they'll soften a little. But, you know, this young, I think this is a bottle you can age.
Oui.
There's
moment,
a softness and a fruitiness.
Yes, you can taste very old Asinone, very good. 1995, 1991, 1993.
All right, so let's talk about the perfect foods to pair this wine with.
Oh.
Not
Bistecca
Vino
Fiorentina.
Don Nobili, but this 2015.
Bistecca Fiorentina.
Bistecca, nice, rare, bloody,
perfect.
Thick steak.
Bistecca Fiorentina is the perfect food to drink
right.
one glass of Vino Nobile Asinone 15, absolutely.
Anything else?
Oh, also cheese, also.
It would be good with
yes,
cheeses, sharp.
Yes. Yes, yes. Pecorino, we call him in area of Pienza, Pecorino Riserva. Very, very nice in very big pieces. It's fantastic.
What about charcuterie? Sliced salami?
Yes. But
not as much.
No, probably is better,
with
more younger wine for
yeah.
this.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
The Vino Nobile.
That's a better match. Mm-hmm. All right, so this is the 2015 Vino Nobile di Montepulciano. This is the Asinone. This is Federico and Francesco's single vineyard. It's about $40.
So it's actually closer to 60.
Okay, so it's closer to 60. At 60, It's still a terrific value. It's a very ageable wine. It's a special wine. When you're going to cut open a huge beefsteak Fiorentino or a ribeye, you don't want a crappy wine. You want a wine that is going to hold up, that has all the characteristics and all of that. So it's about $60. Is it in the market now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I love this wine. And you love the way it came out?
Yep.
Okay.
It's like Francesco's wine for me.
Okay. All right. Federico, Francesco, we're going to wrap up the show. I just want to tell everyone, if they have a question, suggestion, wine happening or event, you could hit me up at sam@thegrapenation.com. That's sam@thegrapenation.com. You can follow us on Facebook at The Grape Nation. We'll post this weekly wine sip. I'll put a picture up of the bottle and, you know, some background information on all our social media sites. Follow us on Instagram at SBenRuby and follow the hashtag The Grape Nation. On Twitter, follow us at BenRuby. Also, subscribe to The Grape Nation podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and Spotify. All right, Federico, Francesco, if we want to find out more information about Poliziano in general, where's the best place to go? Website?
In Poliziano.
Go to Poliziano. But if somebody's sitting here... And...
We're working on the new website. Okay. So within less than a month, everything... You can find us on the website.
Okay.
But Francesco invited you and your the people that...
Radio,
because we have a fantastic hospitality in Poliziano. We have a tasting room.
So when you get to the winery in Poliziano, what happens? You walk out of there and great hospitality area.
Yeah,
tours, tastings.
Tours, tour of the cellar, tour of the vineyards.
Food.
We have food. We have a wonderful villa for our best customer. It's a very, very...
Is that fairly recent in the last 5 years, 8 years?
Actually, the last three, four years.
Okay, yeah, so that's a new direction for the hospitality.
Yeah, absolutely.
The property is so gorgeous, you know, why not do it? Francesco, any social media sites we should be looking at?
Yeah, I think we have an Instagram page, a Facebook page, and...
What's the address?
Poliziano Winery.
Okay.
Yeah.
Poliziano.
That's
look
right.
On Instagram. Look on Facebook.
Facebook.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. If you're not there yet, you guys better get going. When you get back there, I want to make sure you have a good social media presence, because you don't want to lose the opportunity with great wines to not put them in front of people. I'm done lecturing you. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. We're gonna wrap up. I want to thank our guests Federico and Francesco Carletti. They're in New York from Tuscany, from Poliziano Winery. Thank you to our engineer, Vitor, and everyone at the Heritage Radio Network. I'm Sam BenRuby, and you've been listening to The Grape Nation.
Thanks for listening to Heritage Radio Network, food radio supported by you. For our freshest content and to hear about exclusive events, subscribe to our newsletter. Enter your email at the bottom of our website, heritageradionetwork.org. Connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at heritage_radio. Heritage Radio Network is a nonprofit organization driving conversations to make the world a better, fairer, more delicious place. And we couldn't do it without support from listeners like you. Want to be a part of the food world's most innovative community? Rate the shows you like, tell your friends, and please join our community by becoming a member. Just click on the beating heart at the top right of our homepage. Thanks for listening.